I mean, in the Bible, in the apocryphal text of the Bible, they talk about, quote unquote, a counterfeiting spirit, you know, which is precisely pointing at Wetiko. And if I can just say a word about that. So
please.
Wetiko, it's being a counterfeiting spirit. It's an imposter. It actually puts us on, which has a double meaning. It puts us on like a suit of clothes, and it hides itself in identification with us, and it puts us on, which also means to fool us. So it like apes us, and so it's an imposter of who we are, and it presents itself as being ourselves, but it's this limited version of ourselves. And if we're not awake in that moment, we then identify with its false, fictitious version of who we are. And then unknowingly, we've offered ourselves to become an instrument for it to act itself out through us, all the while we're thinking we're just being ourselves.
Hi, this is Bruce Lipton, and you're listening to Planet FM.
Kia ora, greetings, and welcome to Planet FM 104.6. I'm Tim Lynch, and I trust that you are doing well. I invite you to stay with me over the next hour as we discuss and find ways to take care of our unique and magnificent green planet Earth. On the phone from Portland in Oregon in the USA, I have Paul Levy. And Paul has had a very, very interesting life from a standpoint that he had a great awakening way back in the early 1980s, and it allowed him to tap into a greater understanding of who he was, and also to the fact that there is a profound energy within the world or the universe at large that we also can get an understanding and allow us to realize that we're connected to a greater whole. So I'd like to say kia ora and welcome to the radio program here today, Paul.
Yeah, I'm so happy to be here. I just really appreciate the invitation. So thank you.
Yes, Paul, I've heard from my doctor, my family doctor told me about Wetiko, and I thought this is fantastic to be able to hear a very clear statement as to what's happening in the world. So can we start with that? Because I think that will actually give us the understanding so that we can build out from there.
Sure. Yeah. And keep in mind how I came across the Wetiko idea or the Wetiko virus, because it's a mind virus whose source is the human psyche. It was in my family, and I had direct experience with it. And that actually created so much suffering in me that it catalyzed a spiritual awakening a few years later. And then that catapulted me into the clutches of psychiatry. And I'm very thankful that that was very short term. But for the next couple of years, when I was in the psychiatric system, that almost killed me. And I recognized, wait a second, it's the same darker energy that was coming through in my family, through my father. He was the channel. That was now, it was like it was shifting channels and coming through the field of psychiatry. And that's when I began to realize, well, there's like this darker energy that pervades the non-local field and whose origin was consciousness, was in my own mind. So that was the beginning. That was in the early 80s. And it almost drove me crazy. Some people think it did. And that maybe I'd never come back, but that's fine. But it took me over a dozen years of doing intense work on myself, you know, going to therapy, making art, connecting with my dreams, studying Jung.
That's Carl Jung, a Swiss psychologist.
Yeah, Buddhist practice, you know, stepping into shamanism, studying alchemy, just anything and everything that I could find that would help me to deal with the overwhelming suffering that I was experiencing. And I see now with my trauma, really, and the abuse and the wounding that I initially got from my father, it was as if I had gotten a transfusion of the Wetiko virus directly into my soul, and I became sick. I developed this shamanic sickness. And of course, being I was in my early to mid-20s, I had no idea about any of this. And the thing that saved me was when I had the spiritual awakening, and I was so ecstatic at what I was realizing, because in essence, I was realizing that we're having a collectively shared, like a dream. It was like, not like a dream, that this experience that we're sharing is a dream. And I was beginning to wake up to that, oh my God, we're collectively dreaming up our shared experience, this collective dream moment by moment. But I was so excited and so enthusiastic about what I was realizing that it got me in deep trouble. That's what got me hospitalized. And what saved me was that it couldn't have been more clear that I was having an awakening. So I had my entire universe reflecting back to me, oh, you're mentally ill, you have a chemical imbalance, you're going to need to be on medication for the rest of your life. And, you know, I was fortunate, not for one moment did I buy into that, because I knew that something was being shown to me, and not for even a nanosecond did I buy into psychiatric diagnosis. And so then when I got out of psychiatry, like I said, I began doing intense inner work on myself. I had been doing that with, that's what precipitated the awakening. But more and more I began to get in focus. Oh my God, there's this, it's like there's this darker force. That's what the Native American people call Wetiko. It's a psycho-spiritual disease of the soul whose origin is inside of us, in our soul, in the psyche, in the collective unconscious. And it has this seemingly magical power, even though its origin is inside the mind, inside the psyche, inside of us. It has this magical power of somehow being able to extend itself out in the world and configure events, outer events in the world, so as to synchronistically reflect and express the state of a psyche that's under its thrall. So that's an amazing thing I just said. I want to make sure people really follow that, because what I'm pointing at is that it's an inner disease of the soul that elaborates itself through the medium of the outside world. And when you really contemplate that, what that means is that what's happening in the world, in our outer lives, is actually reflecting what's happening in the inner state of our psyche. So that's to say the inner, the outer, and the inner are reflections of each other. And that is exactly the description of a dream. Okay? So, and to keep in mind that the whole spiritual awakening, the way, the really the chief feature, the way I describe it is, oh, I was beginning to have the recognition that we're dreaming, that all of us are unconsciously having this dream, because a dream is the expression of our unconscious. And I was beginning to wake up to that, and I was realizing, oh my God, as more of us wake up to that, we can change the dream. And seeing the dreamlike nature, that's really the way in to seeing Wetiko, because Wetiko works through the blind spot of the psyche. It works through the projective tendencies of our mind in such a way that we unwittingly become the instrument through which it acts itself out, and it does it in a way that we're not aware that we become the conduit for it. So we think everything's fine. And in the meanwhile, if we've fallen under the spell of the bug, then we unwittingly are one of its instruments. Now, keep in mind that everyone has Wetiko in potential. It pervades the collective unconscious, and it feeds off of separation and fear. And so if we think, oh, that person, they really have Wetiko, whoever that person is, whether they're the president of our country or whoever, if we think they have Wetiko and we don't, that point of view is an expression that we ourselves have fallen under the spell of Wetiko.
Yes.
Because it feeds off of polarization. Okay? But if we see them having it, and if we recognize, oh, they're a dream character, they're reflecting that dark, insane, crazy, evil, what, however you would characterize it, that part of myself, and I'm looking in a mirror, then all of a sudden, then we're gaining access to the point of view where we can actually help to heal the disease.
Excellent. Now, can I ask, Western medicine and psychiatric and the psychologist, the word psych is the Greek word soul. And so we've forgotten that whole thing about soul. And we in the West, we come from, say, the last 50, 60, 70 years of a mechanistic reductionist cosmology where we actually see ourselves as a physical body. We come by chance of the Big Bang and everything. We've evolved supposedly from monkeys, blah, 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 and here we are now. just in a physical body with no knowingness of anything outside the realms of the five senses, and yet this Wetiko is coming from, should we say, an indigenous race who actually sees things in far more holistic terms. Can you add to that?
Yeah, totally. Because we've been entranced by the materialistic point of view and thinking that really the thing that's really real is matter. And, you know, I just want to mention, I just wrote a book on quantum physics because I was realizing, oh my God, quantum physics, what the revelations emerging from quantum physics are, it's the medicine for Wetiko. And I'm happy to say more about that.
But yes.
What you're describing, Tim, is the idea, like it makes me think Jung would complain. He goes, yes, with modern psychology, we have a psychology without a psyche, that it's gotten so behavioristic and so scientific and materialistic. And, you know, in dealing with giving people drugs, that they've like actually forgotten about the psyche, which is completely related to the soul. But the indigenous people, they really understand that the sort of the higher dimension that we're contained in and that we're an expression of is not material, but is some sort of spiritual realm whose origin, whether you call it is the psyche or mind or God or spirit or something like that, they're all words that are pointing at that the primary source of our experience is not physical. And now quantum physics comes along, and it actually has empirically proven that the universe that before quantum physics, the classical physicists were studying, which they thought of as being objectively real and separate from us, and they were just trying to understand it as passive observers, quantum physics comes along and actually empirically proves, oh, there is no such thing as an objective world, that on the contrary, the act of observing this universe actually influences the universe observed.
Yes.
And that's the rabbit hole. That's where the revelations from quantum physics are the medicine for Wetiko, you know, because it's pointing at that the act of observation is creative. So quantum physics is pointing at that we, each one of us, have this enormous creative power that we are literally creating moment by moment our experience.
Yes.
Of ourselves and our experience of the world. But if we're not awake to that, that power, in a sense, boomerangs against us in a way that's killing us. And that's what we're seeing writ large on the world stage, okay? Because one way of describing Wetiko in real simple, there are all these ways of describing it. You know, one of its chief features is people who are afflicted with it, they act out completely against their best interest. They'll support political candidates that actually are in service of policies that are killing them. And that's an outer reflection of their inner state. And another quality of Wetiko is that people who are afflicted accuse other people of doing what they themselves are doing. And that's pointing at something, because that's pointing at when somebody is taken over by the Wetiko virus, they actually project onto the inkblot of the waking life. This, like a dream, this is an inkblot. And then they don't recognize that they're actually experiencing their projection. They actually become conditioned to think that what they're seeing out there is other than themselves. Then they react to the reflection of their own projection in a way that entrances them. So we literally hypnotize ourselves by the genius of our own mind, by our own creative potency,
yes,
in a way where we trick ourselves out of our mind. That's in essence, so what Wetiko does, it operates through the projective tendencies of the mind in such a way that it entrances us and we hypnotize ourselves. Quantum physics is showing us, it's the medicine to help us see through that process.
Yeah, fantastic. Yes, I remember I was down in Venice Beach in Los Angeles in 1976, and I came across Fritjof Capra's book, The Tao of Physics, and I realized that the Hindus and the Taoists and the Buddhists and the Zen Buddhists, when they get into a deep state of meditation and consciousness, they recognize that we're all connected, everything. We're just an energy field in a greater universal or divine energy field. And at the moment, what's happened, we've caught up in sort of self-deception and loneliness. because we consume our way to a makeshift freedom, and this makeshift freedom, of course, is taking the whole ecology of our planet and our civilization over the cliff. And so it's in itself an epidemic, and we have to sort of get away from the sort of groupthink and herd mentality and start to take an in-breath into our being and recognize that we have got an inner candle within our own chest cavity, and we've lost that connection to our own inner light. And what you had, from what I gather, was a kundalini awakening. Can you tell people a little bit about this? Because what's inside our being, the microcosm, is as profound as what's outside in the macrocosm.
Yeah, you know, totally, and you're totally right. It was a complete over-the-top kundalini awakening. I was 24, and it was like going from being a 75-watt bulb to yes. a quadrillion-watt bulb. And I'm lucky it didn't kill me. The energy that I had tapped into, it was like tapping into the source.
Yes.
And it was also, there are a lot of ways I can describe it, but it was like getting into alignment with oneself, where all of a sudden, every moment, my subjective experience was that, oh my God, everything I'm doing is creative, that that's my nature. And it was like whatever trauma I had had was getting sort of uninstalled in my operating system. But I was so unprepared for it. I mean, I don't know if anybody could be prepared. And I was, you know, 24 at that point. And stuff began happening in my life that not only was completely mind-blowing and synchronistic, stuff began happening in my life that was physically impossible. That according to my understanding of who I was and according to what I had been taught about the nature of this universe, what was happening in my life was not supposed to be happening. It was completely physically impossible, particularly when I was getting to meet my teachers, these great Buddhist teachers. And it was like when I was in their field, the whole continuum of space and time seemed to just torque or warp in a way that these miracles were happening, that it was so disorienting. And I see now that, yeah, I was being shown something. And here it is almost 40 years later. And, you know, when I'm still unpacking
yes.
what was being shown to me, but more and more I'm able to articulate what I was realizing in a way, instead of freaking people out and having them feel I need to be hospitalized and shut down, I'm at the point now where people are, like, really interested in what I'm saying and getting benefit and wanting to talk with me more. So I'm really grateful about that, because I've written all these books that are really more and more getting out, that I'm trying to point out that we're having a collective dream. That's what quantum physics empirically
yes.
has proven, that the act of consciousness has entered into the physics lab. It's not what the physicists signed up for. They can't get rid of it. It needs to be factored into the equation of how we're co-creating reality. And another way of describing that is that, yeah, quantum physics, not only is it pointing at the dreamlike nature, but quantum physics is an expression of the very dreamlike nature at which it is pointing. So since when we literally have dreamed up quantum physics 100 years ago, a little bit more, into the world and into our minds, so as to help us awaken to our incredible creative power. And so that, in essence, that's in very simple form what my work is really about, is trying to switch people on that we are these geniuses. We have this incredible superhero power, all of us. Every moment we're wielding it. But to the extent that we're not conscious of it, it's being turned against us in a way that not only isn't serving us, but is killing us. And as more and more of us wake up and are able to consciously plug in to this superhero power, and that's nothing other than our creative potency. It's our actual agency. And as more and more of us tap into that and connect with other people who are tapping into that, we can connect with each other in a way where we can literally change the waking dream we're having. And that's not New Age woo-woo. That's actually what this is all about. And that's to participate in our own evolution.
Yes, we, in many cases, we are the ones we have been waiting for.
Yeah, totally.
And the other thing is, too, is that every baby born into this realm is an energy bundle of exponential potential. And what happens when they get into this world, they find, they say, oh, keep quiet, go to bed, don't say that. And we get so many no's, and we're closed down, when in actual fact, by the time we're about 4 or 5 years of age, we've had maybe 400 definitions of no and only about 7 or 15 definitions of yes. And I think this is one of the big challenges, is to be able to get around beside our children and find a positive way in which to allow them to create themselves into a greater realm and a greater knowingness.
Yeah, you're totally right, you know, because I've, you know, we all have to go through our version of that. Like, for me, made reference to the abuse and the wounding and the trauma and with my father, and it was basically when I was realizing, when I was in college, that I was an artist, that I had the soul of an artist, and I totally just felt called to just step into that. And he took that, the way he interpreted that impulse was that that needed to be obliterated in me. And that just created enormous suffering. But of course, instead of having it shut me down, it made me even more, you know, just compelled to want to be creative. And I'm fortunate that I was able to hold it in that way. But what I'm pointing at is that we've all experienced a form of abuse or trauma. And what you're saying with little kids, with babies, when they come into the world, they're domesticated, they're indoctrinated, they're conditioned. They're told what's right and wrong and good and bad. But in essence, the real essence of abuse is that when we shine our light and express ourselves and just be who we are, that we're basically told that's not okay. It's like we get the message that it's a dangerous situation if we actually express ourselves. So we internalize that message in our own head, and then we become our own control system. And so what I'm pointing out is that when you begin to add light to that, the good news is that there is no one else really doing it to us. Yeah, in the past, historically, we might have suffered particular trauma or a message or abuse from a parent or educational system, but then it becomes internalized. That's terrible. But the good part is now there's no one else who's doing it to us but ourselves, which means we can undo it.
Excellent.
And, you know, and that's what spiritual practice really is.
Yes, well, in many ways we are embryo gods, and it's time for us to flower. I mean, there was this in 1967, this flowering of consciousness in the so-called flower power movement, and for a wee while there was this bright flash of inspiration that came through, and then finally it sort of fell away again due to the fact that it couldn't be embraced to the degree that we all wanted it. And now there's this second movement of humanity waking up. We're sort of in a situation where you're a pioneer of spiritual emergence and into this awakening that's happening now. And we need to know that there is, in every country, humanity are realizing that what they see in the world in many ways is a huge lie. And it is not people or humanity friendly. It's not loving. It's just a harsh system of control around technology and a system that really doesn't factor children into the coming future.
Yeah, totally. And you're totally right that there are people all over the world who are in different phases of awakening. And part of that, as you were describing, like in 1967, that there was this huge awakening with psychedelics and just an expansion of consciousness and in music and art and all that. And then it kind of went underground. And what that brought up in me is that what I've learned to deal with and to navigate, and I've realized this isn't just a personal process, but this is an archetypal process that we all have, you know, to experience in our own way, that as I get close to my light and express my light, you know, and who I am, invariably it seems to attract the opposite. It seems
yes.
to attract these darker forces that seem to want to shut down the light. And at first, when this first began happening a number of years ago, I really sort of, I interpreted it like, wow, I must be really screwed up, or I have a problem, or this is bad, or it's my an obscuration. And all of that's true from one point of view. But more and more, as I've evolved and matured, I understand when those darker forces are getting invoked because I'm actually expressing my light, that's actually a good sign. That's showing that I'm on the right path, that those darker forces are actually allies. They can actually, you know, I mean, of course, if I relate to them as darker forces, as other than myself, and try to fight with them, well, then I've already lost. Then I've actually gotten snared by them, and then they are obstacles. But if I can recognize, oh, of course, you know, there would be darker forces that as I step into my light that are trying to stop me, that's an indication that I'm on the right path. Great. Then they become allies. And, you know, and one way to understand that, when the Buddha himself was under the Bodhi tree about to become enlightened, what happened? The darker forces came and were, like, tormenting him and trying to obscure him, you know, and stop him and seduce him in every way imaginable. And he recognized that they were allies, that they actually helped him to recognize the dreamlike nature even more and to connect even more with his compassion. So these darker forces were actually secretly on his side. They were helping him to cultivate the muscle of realization. And, you know, so that's the alchemy, where we can transmute the seeming darker forces, because as soon as we fight them and see them as other, then we're playing their game, and then we've become hooked.
Yes. Our vibrations drop down to their vibes. And so I guess it's discernment and an inner voice. Can you tell us a little bit about this, how still we can become so that we can listen clearly to our higher self, to some...
Yeah, for sure. So it's interesting because going back to the Wetiko virus is a daimonic energy. And the word daimonic, it connotes an energy that's not just personal, but is transpersonal and archetypal, and it can take over a human being. It can literally possess someone.
Can you spell that?
Unwittingly. Yeah, it's either spelled D-A-E-M-O-N, daimon, you know, I-C, or D-A-I-M-O-N-I-C.
Thank you.
So it's spelled two ways, but the word is daimonic. And the daimon, actually the etymology of the word, so it's an energy that is archetypal, transpersonal, can take over a person. We can become totally possessed by it and just become an instrument for it. But here's the thing. Etymologically, what the daimon, what it means, it's the guiding spirit. It's the inner voice. It's the genius. It connects us with our calling. It's to hear a voice. It connects us with our vocation. And the idea being that the daimon, it's that still small voice within that if we get in relationship to it, it will help us. It's the angel. It's our inner angel. It will help us find our calling. We'll hear its voice, we'll find our vocation, we'll discover who we are, we'll figure out what we're here to do, and encoded in the daimon is our creative spirit. But here's the rub. If you turn away from the daimon because, oh, I'm scared of it, or I'm not good enough, or I'm not talented enough, or whatever story you tell yourself, then that daimon, which actually is our greatest aid, constellates negatively and becomes a demon, okay? So the point is that encoded in Wetiko, you see, Wetiko is a quantum phenomena. And what I mean, just like quantum phenomena, there's a superposition of opposite states. So, like, think about, well, what is the nature? Here is light. What is the nature of light? Well, sometimes it manifests as a wave, sometimes as a particle. Now, you can't imagine more opposite contradictory states than a particle and a wave. And yet, the nature of light is that it's either or a particle or a wave, depending on how you observe it. The same thing with Wetiko. Being quantum, it's the source of the greatest evil. And it has the most unbelievable medicine, and not just medicine, it's actually helping us. It's actually blessing us. If Wetiko didn't exist, we would have to invent it. That's how important it is, because it's catalyzing our evolution. But how it manifests, is it going to kill us? Is it going to take us down? Or is it going to wake us up? It depends if we recognize what it's revealing to us. Because Wetiko, it's a revelation. And I'm pointing out that the coronavirus is a lower dimensional reflection of the Wetiko mind virus, which is a virus of the mind that's emanating itself into our 3D world as the coronavirus. And the coronavirus only on one level is physical. It has a mental vector. It's affecting all of our minds. It has a behavioral vector. It's a multidimensional phenomena. And there's a way, and I've recently written all these articles about this, there's a way of looking and seeing the coronavirus pandemic and recognizing, oh my God, it's helping us to see the Wetiko mind virus. Because if you don't see the Wetiko mind virus, keep in mind it operates through the blind spots, then Wetiko has power over us and it can kill us. But as soon as we begin to recognize how the Wetiko mind virus operates through the field out in the world, and how it operates through our unconscious reactions via our blind spots in our mind, once you see it, then you take away its power over you and you become empowered. And that's when you step into your creative agency.
Very good. Okay. I'm speaking with Paul Levy on Wetiko and what it is. And you can check him out, particularly either his books, but better, look up YouTube, Paul Levy. Now, Paul, we've got 7.7 billion people here on the Earth at the moment, and they're very challenged. I mean, this virus now is causing so many people to sort of wake up in the morning, and they're very sort of wonky. They're not sort of solid in their own being. They've taken in so much from the outside world that they're wobbly. Can you suggest things for us to do to bring about a change where we change from within and connect to our family and our neighbours and our community, and we spread out as cells connecting with other cells until we start to sort of envelop?
Yeah.
Can you?
For sure. And like, yeah, totally. And an example, when I was saying like Wetiko, it's a quantum phenomena that is, you know, encoded within it are both of the opposites. Well, the same thing with the coronavirus. On the one hand, it's a nightmare, and it's creating hell on earth and just, you know, catalyzing so much suffering. And yet, encoded in the phenomena, in the pandemic, it's helping us to wake up. It's becoming easier to wake up because people are walking around going, oh, my God, this is so surreal. Exactly. The dreamlike nature is revealing itself. And when you recognize the dreamlike nature, one other way of saying that is you recognize that we're not separate, that we're interdependent, we're interconnected, that we depend on each other for our own well-being. So all of a sudden, even though it's very, very challenging and creating the suffering, it actually is making it even more obvious and more clear that we're all, like I was saying, interconnected. And that's one of the other, you see, there are three ways of seeing through Wetiko. Because, you know, Wetiko, it operates, it only has power over us if we don't see it. So one way is to see that we're having a dream, a collective dream that we're all dreaming up together. So to see the dreamlike nature, the second way, and they're all interconnected, these three ways, is to recognize that we don't exist as a separate self. And the expression of that is compassion, is the open heart of compassion. And the third way is to see that there's a non-local field. That, you see, being a quantum universe, because quantum physics has shown this is a quantum universe on every scale. It's quantum through and through. And a quantum universe is whole. There's no, it's seamless. There's no separate parts that are interacting. It's a whole system. So those three things, the non-local field, the dreamlike nature, and seeing through the illusion of the separate self, they're all interrelated aspects of the same realization. And the expression of that is compassion. And the whole point is when you see that, it opens your heart. But then, you know, it's not enough just to sort of see it and have it be an individual experience. But the idea being, yeah, okay, what do we do with that? How do we relate with other people? And then the point is to be of service. And the way I'm going to be of service, it's going to look different than with anybody else. We all have our unique calling. And calling, like I was saying, is related etymologically to the word, to the daimon, and that has to do with being creative. Because I'm just talking from my own experience. Since the pandemic happened, I'm out of control. I can't stop writing. I just cannot believe how, yeah, I could have chosen to act out and indulge in whatever habitual patterns, but yet somehow I feel the urgency. And I've been able to tap into the creative spirit that comes through all of us. And that's the medicine. For any of us to express ourselves creatively is the very thing that really dispels Wetiko and heals our soul and connects us with who we are.
Yes, the movie, the never-ending story, that children's movie, it was about 35, 40 years ago. I mean, the nothing, this nothing was coming from all directions and was slowly consuming the whole existence or the whole world of all these people. And they were getting into a desperate situation, and then finally a bright spark said, hey, let's be creative. And all of a sudden, the community in that world started to become creative and started to draw on talents that they didn't have. And in that moment, their creativity started to push the nothing away, and it dispelled it in the end. And I guess this is...
That's exactly it.
Yeah, that's exactly it. And for children, this is a children's story.
Yeah, no, totally. And the thing, so it's so cool that you say that, because, you see, the thing about Wetiko, and keep in mind, it's not just Native American people. Every spiritual tradition and so many creative artists and thinkers and philosophers. I mean, in the Bible, in the apocryphal text of the Bible, they talk about, quote unquote, a counterfeiting spirit, you know, which is precisely pointing at Wetiko. And if I can just say a word about that. So Wetiko, it's being a counterfeiting spirit. It's an imposter. It actually puts us on, which has a double meaning. It puts us on like a suit of clothes. And it, so it hides itself in identification with us, and it puts us on, which also means to fool us. So it like apes us, and it, so it's an imposter of who we are, and it presents itself as being ourselves, but it's this limited version of ourselves. And if we're not awake in that moment, we then identify with its false, fictitious version of who we are, and then unknowingly we've offered ourselves to become an instrument for it to act itself out through us, all the while we're thinking we're just being ourselves. Just an example, like when we get, like, say, physically, if we get, like, a tapeworm in our system, the tapeworm will secrete chemicals in us, in our body, such that we start to crave food that will feed the tapeworm.
Junk food.
And all the while we're thinking we're feeding ourselves. So the tapeworm grows bigger and bigger till it actually kills the host, which is us. But it doesn't want to kill us too soon, because then we'd suffer the inconvenience of having to find this new host. So the thing about Wetiko is that it doesn't even ultimately exist. There is no such thing as Wetiko. It has no independent intrinsic existence whatsoever. It's like that nothing you were talking about. And yet it can destroy our species. See, that's the paradox. Because Wetiko, it can't steal our soul, but it can literally trick us into giving our soul away. See, because that's the thing about evil, because Wetiko is the source of the greatest evil, is that evil only has power if we collude with it, you know? And that's why I'm saying Wetiko operates through our blind spots. And so what I'm pointing at with my work, it's like I've been mapping this, both how it works outwardly in the world and inwardly in our minds. And as more and more of us see this, you free yourselves from it. And then when you connect with other people who see it, that's when you sort of create this network of light, which can, you know, and that becomes contagious, because Wetiko, it's contagious. It spreads through the unconscious of people. And what I'm pointing out is that once you actually get on and see how it works, and you connect with other people who are also awakening to the dreamlike nature and are able to dispel Wetiko, then we're able to connect with each other and actually, in a real way, change the dream, the waking collective dream we're having. And that's, in a sense, what this is all about.
Thank you. Yes, well, can I throw in... not necessarily a spanner, but another way of looking at things. I've been in, sort of over the years, I've been in touch with information like soul retrieval of Sandra Ingerman and Michael Hana. And I've been on the periphery of a lot of Indigenous peoples. And I was in Australia many years ago and came across a part Aboriginal person who was into clearing, should we say, entities from people. And up until then, I'd heard many stories of Indigenous people saying, oh, that person is sick, and the reason why that person is sick is that he's got an evil spirit. And I thought, well, okay. I sort of didn't hold on to it. And then somebody said, oh, an entity has got into him. And all of a sudden, I thought, entity? What's that? And then pennies started to drop. And I listened to this and spent some time with this Aboriginal, and it's described as, if you're in your house and it's dark at night, and you go down to your fridge and it's still dark, and you don't turn the lights on, and you pick up your torch and turn it on, and you go in and you open up the fridge and you put your torch inside the fridge and then you close the door again. And it's supposed to be all dark. But if there is any light coming out of the, shall we say, the seals of that fridge, that means there's light leaking from there. And to the degree that they say this is what happens within our own being, if we are out of sorts, if we are suffering from either drug addiction or alcoholism, or we're just extremely out of phase, this allows a darker energy to home in on that light and get through that seal into your being. And, so I've been in process and seen how this works, and there is that quality too. There is, as you say, evil is very cunning and it will do whatever it can to basically destroy the light. And so I'm just asking that question, you know, with First Nations. You've been up in America, and I've been to an Apache Indian full moon ceremony out in the Arizona desert. I've had all sorts of experiences to realize that the indigenous peoples have got a fantastic understanding of so many things.
Totally. And what you're saying, I mean, it's so right on, because Wetiko, it's a vampire. And think about what a vampire is. It's the living dead. It doesn't have a life of its own. Just like a virus doesn't have a life of its own, it needs a living being to feed off of its energy. And, you know, one, it's something we all experience. I mean, think about, there are certain people you hang out with and afterwards you just feel drained.
Yes.
And then there are other people you hang out with and you're both filled up and have more creative energy after
inspired.
Hanging out.
And inspired, yes.
And
yes.
Inspired, right. So it's exactly like that. So it's not any sort of esoteric thing, no. So, I mean, in my work, I talk about the vampire archetype, and I point out it's a really equivalent with Wetiko. Now, I want to just go back to something, because you're right. The native, the indigenous people have this incredible wisdom. And before the pandemic happened, I wrote this major article that's now become, you know, because I have a new book coming out. It's the companion volume to Dispelling Wetiko. And this major new article on the shamanic archetype is now one of the major chapters in the new book. Because what I was realizing, you see, because one way of understanding the... So I had no idea about shamanic anything when I was in my early 20s, when I was just deeply suffering. And then I had my awakening, and then I was hospitalized and thought I had really screwed up. But afterwards, I realized, no, the hospitalization, that was part of the awakening. That was, in a way, the shamanic descent into the underworld. And I literally couldn't believe the madness and the abuse and the insanity that psychiatry was perpetrating on their patients. So all of a sudden, over the years, I began to realize, wow, I've gotten drafted, enlisted into the shamanic initiatory process. And so then I wrote this major article on shamanism, like I said, right before the pandemic. And what I was basically pointing at, or what I was most interested in, is when somebody becomes a shaman, and it's something you would never in a million years in your right mind choose to do, because the suffering is just too intense. But if you're being called, and if you remember, the daimon, etymologically, is related to being called. If we're called by the spirit, if we resist and say no, that's when the would-be shaman gets really sick. But as soon as you assent and say, okay, I will follow this, then you get supported. But what happens with a shaman? They're so permeable and so empathic and sensitive that they literally take on the sickness in the field or in the other person they're working with. And taking it on means to confront it, to have it out, but also it means taking it within themselves. And they literally become sick. They experience the sickness from the inside, that it's an inside job. And in a sense, we are all shamans in training. We've all been sickened by the collective madness, i.e. Wetiko, that pervades the non-local field. And we're actually being demanded, like a shaman, they become sick, but then what makes them an accomplished shaman is they're able to find their way back to health. They're able to find their way back to center, to their wholeness, back to the self. And by connecting with their wholeness, that light then metabolizes the illness. They then become back to being well themselves, and non-locally, energetically, that transmits to the community or the patient or whoever they're working with and helps them to heal too. So we are all being cast in the role of the would-be shamans is basically the point.
Thank you, yes. Well, the old saying, I think it goes back millennia, we are spiritual beings having an earth experience. And I know Teilhard de Chardin, it talks about us at this moment, we're coming to an omega point. where where all the whole human family are coming closer and closer together from a standpoint of instantaneous communication right around the planet. And that's just sort of one thing. But we're just aware of the fact that we are in the birth canal to a great new paradigm. And in a birth canal and a process, there's lots of pain and it's messy. And so this is where...
Yeah, if I could just say one thing about that, because you're so right on, because I wrote this major article where I talk about that never before have we experienced being so polarized. We're between whatever, the opposites, the right or the left. You can't even talk to people who have different points of view.
Yes.
And from the dreaming point of view, when you look at this symbolically as if it's a dream, the symbols of the language of dreams, when there's polarization, that's an expression that there's some sort of birth that's happening. When there's disassociation, Jung he refers to it as our species is suffering from a sickness of disassociation. We're extremely dissociated, we're polarized, inwardly, individually, collectively as a species. From the dreaming point of view, that's an expression that there's something that's being birthed through us. And we are simultaneously the new being that's being given birth to. We're the mothers of the being, and we're the midwives. We're all of it. And of course, you know, how is it going to turn out? Are we just going to blow ourselves up and destroy ourselves? Or are we going to actually, you know, somehow create this new world that's more in alignment with who we're discovering ourselves to be? That's yet to be seen. That's up to us.
Well, I found that during the lockdown here in New Zealand, we went into it on the 25th of March, and we were put away in our houses, so to speak, but we could walk around the streets, and I could walk along the beach, and I met so many people, and everyone was sort of really concerned. And so the connection between all these people who I'd never seen before was such that in that moment, in that little moment where we shared, "Hi, good to see you, how are you going?" we made that connection. We realized that we had more in common at that stage than we had differences. And I come right back to the fact that we have to start with ourselves and our family and community, our neighbors, and realize that we get by with a little help with our friends. And I found myself in a situation being given so many things like food, and I had fresh fish so often from different people, and fruit and veggies. And we realize that as neighbors and community, there is this spark that holds the light for us. There is something there when we just take in that in-breath and realize that we are a global family.
Absolutely. And that's the idea. You see, I do Tibetan Buddhist practice. In Buddhism, there's the three jewels: Buddha, the Dharma, the Sangha, the teacher, the teaching, and the community of fellow awakening beings. And a lot of people are feeling that the Sangha might be the most important of the jewels, the community. And the idea being, you know, it's one thing if any one of us, you know, begins to wake up, but that's just, in a sense, yeah, that's going to improve our lives, but that's not the point. The point is that when you wake up, it's the bodhisattvic ideal. The bodhisattva is awakening into nirvana. They're about to step into nirvana, and they look back. And they see all their fellow suffering brothers and sisters.
Yes.
And that's when they make the bodhisattva vow, "I'm not going to enter nirvana until I bring everybody else there first." Because who is everybody else? They're aspects of me. They're not separate from me. So the point is, we can connect with each other instead of projecting the shadow on each other and acting out our abuse and re-traumatizing each other. We can actually, it's what I call dream ourselves awake. We can conspire to co-inspire each other, which is a true conspiracy theory, and we can activate the collective genius where the sum is, where the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. There is a way when we get in phase with each other, we can activate what I call the sacred power of our dreaming. That's the part of us that's moment by moment dreaming this waking dream into materialization. We're doing it anyway, every moment, 24/7, but most of it are doing it unconsciously.
Yes.
When you connect with other people who are also waking up to it. And one way of understanding this, a beautiful way, is like imagine being in a dream. And if you're in a night dream and you have lucidity, you've woken up in the dream, and then you connect with other of your dream characters in the dream, and you hang out and you contemplate what you're realizing. What are you realizing? You're realizing that the dream universe you're in is just a function of your own dreaming. And once you hang out with people who are having that realization, you discover, oh my God, I can change the dream. I can create a dream that's way more reflective of who we're discovering ourselves to be, which is that we're not separate. And, you know, that's what I keep on coming back to. That's evolutionary, and we're being invited to step into that and to consciously participate in that process with each other.
This is fantastic, Paul. Back in the mid-90s, I was living in Australia, and a time where I talked about dream time in a system, that when we go to bed at night, we commit to actually go into our dreams and then connect with our family and our friends. And in this lucid state, we start to work out what we're going to do for this world in the future, so that we sort out our networks and what needs to be done, so that sometime in this fast coming future, we may be able to wake up and we know exactly what to do, because we've made all our contacts on the Dreamtime inner system, that we've practiced our roles, and everybody whom we've contacted in our dreams will contact their friends and their friends and their friends, so that we actually have a whole network of friends globally. And then when this wonderful event happens where we come through the birth canal, we know exactly what to do.
Yeah. No, it's like we have the intelligence. It's latent in us. It's just waiting for the right moment in time and for the right, you know, sort of catalyst. And if I could just say one thing that I feel is probably the most important, I just wrote an article about this just today. You know, I've been thinking about it so much, and it's so inspiring, because here we are, and we go to sleep every night, and we have these dreams at night. And, you know, when they really are, you know, they can help us, and they're typically compensations. When we get off balance or one-sided, the symbols in the dreams are helping us to connect back to who we are. And they're typically very, it's not even a question whether they're good or bad dreams. They're all in the service of helping us and healing us. And what I'm pointing at is that our dreams themselves, the way that our dreams are constructed, actually are showing us something really important about who we are. And what I mean is as follows. So say you're in a night dream, right? And you're holding a particular point of view in the night dream, whatever that viewpoint is. Well, the dream, which is nothing other than your own psyche, has no choice but to reflect back your viewpoint. So all of a sudden you're holding a viewpoint, and then the dream is just reflecting your viewpoint, because the dream is nothing other than your own mind. And then you now have all the evidence you need confirming to yourself the seemingly objective truth of your viewpoint, which makes you even more fixed and entrenched in holding that viewpoint. And the more fixed and entrenched you are in holding the viewpoint, the more the dream will prove to you and offer you confirmation and give you evidence to confirm the objective truth of the viewpoint ad infinitum. It's a feedback loop, self-perpetuating feedback loop, whose origin is your own mind. And what's actually happened, you've hypnotized yourselves, you've entranced yourselves, and that's our situation in our waking dream. We have used that creative dreaming power, that genius, for us to create our experience of reality and of ourselves in a way, that's what I was pointing at before, it boomerangs in a way that we literally entrance ourselves and hypnotize ourselves. But if you actually see through that and you recognize, oh, wow, the nature of my situation is I'm in a dream, that it's not anything separate from me. See, this is what quantum physics is pointing at, because quantum physics, it, like I was saying, it's proven there's nothing objective. If you think quantum physics, the way they set up their experiments and asked the questions they did and interpreted the data, that determined the answer. There was nothing objective, that they were actually participating in creating the very answers they got from their experiment. That's revealing to us the nature of the incredible creative power that all of us have. And very simply, all I'm pointing at is that when you contemplate dreaming and seeing how dreaming works and seeing the dreamlike nature of this, you actually begin to connect with this infinite creative power that we've always had, but we just don't know it. And when you actually get in touch with that and connect with other people who are also awakening to that, then all bets are off.
Yes. Well, this is fantastic, Paul. Thank you. And love, making sure that our heart is open and soft when we go to sleep. And when I go to bed at night, I put my head down on the pillow and I go to God. And that's all I can do, and just trust in this process.
Yeah, and that reminds me, in Tibetan Buddhism, like, they think all of life is a preparation for the moment of death, that you want to be in an open-hearted, you know, compassionate state. And each day is sort of a microcosm of the greater fractal of that. So absolutely, to go to bed, to really just to forgive whatever happened, to just get into as lucid of a state and open-hearted of a state, and that will inform your dreams, definitely.
Yes. Oh, this is fantastic. I've, in some ways, say to my friends, well, we're in this process. We're in this journey through into a new paradigm. We're in the birth canal, and we're, in some ways, being red-pilled all the way through, so that when we do come out the other end, we are ready to participate in the global family, in this new vibration of humanity coming together to see we are one. And in many cases, I like to use the analogy there that we are all individual snowflakes in the ocean of consciousness. And even though we dissolve into the ocean, the archetype of each individual snowflake has its own frequency or vibration or fingerprint or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, totally. And we all have our own, like, you know, the particular, this role to play. My role is to be maybe speaking or giving interviews or talks or writing books or facilitating groups, like all the different stuff I do, but it's different for each one of us. And the important thing is to really try to find what's your role and to have the courage to step into that and just to trust that in doing that, you're going to be supported. And that's the whole idea of the shamanic calling, that if we have the courage to really to ascend to that, then we get sponsored by that spirit that's calling us. But the greatest poison in the human psyche is unexpressed creativity. If we don't have the courage to really step up and express who we are and to shine our light, invariably that feeds pathology.
Thank you so much for those words. Because of courage, there are many women friends, and they say, the men are not present. Where are the men? And so I'm calling for men to really be courageous. And do you want to say something in the last half minute on courage to step out into the greater realm?
Yeah, totally. And, you know, with my teachers, these great lamas, when I would travel with them so often, and invariably when people would be really suffering, they would always answer, have courage. That would be their go-to bottom line answer. But courage, it's not like an alpha male image of courage, but it's really like the open heart of compassion. That, and don't underestimate the power of compassion, that's really, to me, really having the most courage is to have an open, undefended heart.
Paul, this is wonderful. Thank you very much for just pouring it all in and just letting it all flower. Thank you, brother. Greatly appreciate it. And we may have to get you back sometime because of Tibetan Buddhism and reincarnation. Reincarnation is most probably one of my most profound little secrets. I think it's wonderful. And so thank you again. Can you stay on the line?
Yeah, no, I so appreciate the invitation. And I really, Tim, I just can't thank you enough. So thank you so much. It's my pleasure.
Decide to network. Use every letter you write, every conversation you have, every meeting you attend, every email you send. And remember, even Facebook. To tweet and to express your fundamental beliefs and dreams. Affirm to others the vision of the world you want. Network through thought. Network through action. Network through love. Network through the spirit. You are the center of a network. You are the center of the world. You are a free, immensely powerful source of life and goodness. Affirm it. Spread it. Radiate it. Think day and night about it, and you will see a miracle happen. The greatness of your own life in a world of big powers, media and monopolies. But of 7.7 billion individuals, networking is the new freedom, the new democracy, a new transparency, and a new form of wholeness and happiness. This originated by Dr. Robert Muller, Chancellor of the World Peace University in Costa Rica, Central America. I invite you to be able to come to greenplanetfm.com, where we have over 500 interviews in our database, which you can readily download and listen to be able to inspire yourself to become the change you want to see in the world. And become involved in caring for your children and grandchildren's future. We are also on Facebook, on Green Planet FM, and ourplanet.org. Please come and love us. This is Tim Lynch.
And Lisa Eyre.
In the spirit of Aroha, wishing you a wonderful week. We look forward to being with you next week. I say, Kia kaha and haere rā.